Java arrays. So similar to C, Java also contains the arrays. So let's see what are the differences between the C arrays and the Java arrays. So let's start. So arrays in case of Java. So just like C, arrays in Java can be defined as an array is a group of same type of items referred by a common name. So basically array consists of group of elements which are of same data type. But the big difference is in Java the arrays are always dynamically allocated. So we can say in case of C the arrays can be stored on stack, but in case of Java the arrays will be always stored on heap, or the memory for the arrays will be always allocated on a heap. Now one more difference is in case of Java the arrays are treated as an object, not as a primitive data type, but the arrays will be treated as an object. Now due to this we can say for the arrays we have the direct superclass as a java.lang.object. Now since the arrays are treated as an object in Java, we can find the length of the arrays by using one operator, one member, and the member name is itself the length. So in case of arrays in Java, we can find out the length of the array by using the member called as a length. Now how can we declare arrays in Java? So the arrays can be declared in case of Java in such a way. So data type, which denotes the type of the element which are going to be stored in an array. Then this square bracket denotes the corresponding thing is an array, and the actual variable name will now denote the name of the array. Now when we have the declaration of array in such a way, this is not actually allocate a memory for an array, but this will create a reference variable. This will create a reference variable which is allocated on stack. Alternatively, you can have the array declaration in this way. Now in this case there are two sides of the equation. One is the left hand side and another is the right hand side. Now the left hand side for this declaration is nothing but the actual reference variable, and it will be stored onto the stack, while the right hand side is nothing but the actual array for which the memory will be allocated on a heap. And since we are using the keyword new, we say the array is dynamically allocated. Now similar to this, we can declare the array by actually assigning the number of elements. Now let's try to see a quick demo how we can declare the array and how the memory will be allocated and how we can access the elements in an array. So let's declare the array of three integers. So when I say int arr, it's just a reference variable whose name is arr and which will be stored onto the stack, and when I write this, no memory will be allocated. Now if I want to allocate the memory for three integers, I have to write, I am going to allocate the size of three integers. So this can be written in this way. So this particular new keyword will allocate the corresponding memory on heap, and how much memory will be allocated is nothing but the size of three integers, that is 4 into 3, total 12 bytes will be allocated on a heap. Now once I create this array, it will allocate the size of three integers on heap, and every element will be by default initialized to 0. Now you can access the size of the array by using the length member and the name of the array. So array.length will print the size of the array in terms of the number of elements. So it will print the size of the array is nothing but 3. Now similarly, I can access the elements in an array by using a simple for loop. So for int I is equal to 0, I is less than arr.length I plus plus. So I, we can call it as an iterator which will identify every index of an array, and then I can print every element in an array by using the index I. So I can say system.out.println arr of I. Now we try to run this code. Now here you can see all the three elements are by default initialized by array to 0. Now if I want to initialize the elements in an array at the time of declaration, I can initialize it in this way. So let's say the first element will be 20, the next element will be 40, and the last element will be the 100. So at index 0 we have the element called as 20, at index 1 we have the element called as 40, and at index 2 we have element whose value is 100. Now you can see the corresponding array is being initialized in this way. Now all the array elements, as we said, are by default initialized to 0 if we not initialize the array.